Good evening and welcome to yet another episode of Watching You. I'm Jeff Scott in St. John, New Brunswick, and joining me from Stewiacke, Nova Scotia is Jeff Gray. How's it going, Jeff?
Great. How are you doing, Jeff?
Oh, not too bad, not too bad. So it's been a long time. It feels like a long time.
It has been a while, but I think it was good to let the other show germinate a little bit. Like the mm-hmm. other show was certainly, as you can tell, we had a lot of fun talking about it, but we're getting lots of responses from it. And you know, when you and I are discussing what to do for this show, it's really twigging me to, you know, when I look at the shows that we've done so far, the two most popular shows we've done are The Elder Show, and then the other one was The Phantom.
No doubt. The Phantom was my favorite show.
But yeah, I liked them both. Yeah. I liked them both. Yeah. But it's interesting to see what people are interested in. You know, it's not the normal stuff. It's the kind of the landmark, for better or worse, the landmark things that KISS have done. Right. So, you talked a while ago about us talking about, you know, the reunion coming mm-hmm. out, you know, talking about that. And we also talked about when a critical point in their career when they took the makeup off.
Yeah.
Right. So I think, I think that's a good topic. I think we should spend some time on that.
Definitely. Just before we go any further, we should note we didn't plan this. We're both wearing KISS t-shirts tonight. So, and the logos look almost, from the top, they look like the same shirt, but they are slightly different in design. And tonight I'm using for the first time my hand-painted Love Gun background, which looks pretty cool. It looks better than I thought it would. So,
yeah, there it is. Our wall is hand-painted as well.
I can see that.
Yeah.
I can see the brush strokes.
It is. But I thought you'd get a kick out of the shirt because we had this conversation a while ago about me not wearing any swag, right? Remember I said I had one piece of swag left? This is it.
Yeah, that's it, the KISS t-shirt.
But you know what's funny? You know what's funny? And, you know, going off topic, but there's nothing, I don't know. Those pictures that Ian Stanley had of the 1977 concert,
mm-hmm.
I was in that audience, right, as you know, right? And I could actually pinpoint the location that I was at in some of those photos. I couldn't see myself because I couldn't, you know. You talk about swag. I used to have this. I remember when we went to Moncton to see that concert. I had a 1970. It was 1977, and we were. I remember before the show, we went to the Moncton Mall. There was a mall there somewhere on Mountain Road, and I found this one KISS T-shirt that I'd never seen before, and it said KISS, and it was done in these, like, I don't know, it was like plastic, you know, multicolored KISS, and all it said on it was KISS Concert Tour.
Kind of like the Mood T-shirt.
Yeah, and it said, on the bottom it said KISS Concert Tour 1977, that's all it said.
Yeah.
And that was my only piece of swag, and I had it for years and years and years, and it got all holy, and then one day I went, after I got, my wife and I got married, a few years ago, I went to look for that shirt, and I said, "Where's my KISS T-shirt?" And she said, "I threw it out because it was holy." And to this day, she hasn't lived that down. That's some 30 years ago.
Right? What you need is a shirt that's unholy.
Oh God. Oh yeah, I don't
unholy.
Yeah, burrow right to your brain, buddy.
Yeah,
but
so our topic. Oh, if you want to talk about KISS playing Moncton in the 70s and talk about a piece of swag, and this is not a swag, this is a souvenir, you can find these pictures on Facebook if you know exactly where you're
mm-hmm,
looking.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll post a few more here. There's a guy here in St. John, New Brunswick, who caught the body of Paul Stanley's Gibson Marauder, and he smashed one, and this guy caught it. But he swears it's 76. So I did go through the archives. They did play Moncton in 76. That's the Destroyer tour.
Yep.
And this guy has the body of the Marauder. It's hand-signed by Paul Stanley. Wow. I met up with the guy. We did a photo shoot. We laid out a white sheet. We gingerly put this broken body, because it's split right down the middle. It's bare. The pickups are holding the thing together. And we put this thing on a white sheet. I set up my studio lights, and we did a photo shoot of this piece of KISS-tory. It was really cool, and I know Michael Brandvold mentioned it, because I sent him some pictures, and he mentioned it on Three Sides of the Coin. So I'll insert a few pictures here as well. But it's cool.
No, I remember we shared that on our East Coast KISS tribute page, too.
Where you can see it as well on our page.
Yeah, but it's way down in there somewhere. I don't know if it's in the photo section, but it's probably the best way is the way you said. But yeah, no, that was really cool.
So to actually hold that guitar that Paul Stanley signed and smashed, and that's cool, because now what you have to do is you have to pre-order and pay for it. So I'm heading to Newfoundland in 2011. And this is now when Paul Stanley is selling the broken guitars. He's not throwing them out. He's selling them. So I said, it says, click your city. So I clicked on Grand Falls, Windsor, Newfoundland. And the guitar was still available. So I hit buy it now. And $5,000. I thought, $5,000 friggin' dollars. If the money was going to charity, I'd feel better about it. And then I'd say, you know, wow, I contributed to someone's scholarship or needy children or something, and this is what I have to show for it. But knowing that it's going in Paul Stanley's pocket, I need that $5,000 better than he needs.
I'd like to see them mix up the shticks every once in a while. You know, it's funny you mentioned that guitar because I was thinking about it today. I was thinking we're going to go see Kiss here in late end of July and early August. And
are you?
Well, we'll see. We'll see. I'm kind of I'll probably go, but I'm a little pissed off right now. But
I've heard.
Yeah, so but I'll probably go anyway. But I was thinking to myself, you know, are we going to be in the audience going, I wonder if he's going to break a guitar? I think he is. Pretty sure he's going to do it.
You know, when you saw Kiss in 77 in Moncton,
yep.
There was a lot of surprises there. It's no different than when I saw them the first time on the reunion tour in 96. Yeah. I really didn't know what to expect, but now there's so much Kiss on the internet.
Yeah.
People are posting, people are tweeting. We know the entire set list. We know what the new Spider looks like.
Yeah.
There's no surprises. That's what bugs me. We know exactly what to expect.
Yeah,
I know that Paul is going to fly down during Love Gun.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny.
You've walked into the stadium and see that because you'll see the little area roped off.
Exactly. And it's funny you mention that because, it is too bad there's different viewpoints on that spider, but I actually kind of think it looks cool. But one of the other reflections I had upon those photos from 1977 was how small the stage was. Mm-hmm. I remember it being huge. Now, mind you, I saw it from down in the audience, right? But I just remember them being way up on top of these speakers and then coming out on top. I thought they were going to walk down the stairs, and then they actually get lifted out on those little elevators that come down, or whatever you call them, the little lifters.
That's funny. They had the elevators and the stairs.
Yeah, and it comes down.
Well, Ace Frehley was scared of the stairs.
Yeah. Well, no wonder. No wonder.
For many reasons.
Yeah, no kidding. But you know what? The other thing I liked about those photos that Ian took was that, you know, I don't know if you noticed, but there's lots of photos and an Ace is smiling all over the place.
Yes. It looks like they're having a good time.
It really does. And I also remember my eardrums actually did bleed. And, So you go from that to 1983. Mm-hmm. And 1983 is when they took the
So we're finally to our topic.
But that's okay. That's how this thing works, right?
Okay. Jeff, I got a funny feeling this is going to be a short show.
Why?
Well, in 1983, they took off the makeup,
right?
It ain't Kiss.
Well,
next topic.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm not really going to make an argument for that. I think
let's explore it.
Well, what's more interesting to me is, okay, so let's take a look at this. So in 1983, why did they take them? Why did they feel, obviously they took the need off. They felt the need to take the makeup off. And obviously it was they felt it was financially a better decision for them. But let's take a look at, like, let's just discuss it ourselves. Like, why do you think, for instance, in 1983, they felt like they had to take the makeup off? I mean, they just did what the last four albums prior to that were Dynasty, Unmasked, Music from the Elder, Creatures of the Night. And then they presented us with Lick It Up and with the makeup off. So why do you think?
Well, it's time for Jeff Scott's theory.
Yeah.
I got a zillion theories.
Yes.
Look, here's the thing. When they came out in 73, people said, you're actually going to do this in makeup. And people thought they looked ridiculous. Maybe they do. I mean, you got to put yourself in 1973. Someone coming out and doing that on stage, yes, it's a bit ridiculous. It's taking Bowie and Cooper and all those, you know, theatrical acts and going so much further with it. But it does look a bit ridiculous. But they stuck to their guns, and they went through thick and thin and fire and hell, and they finally came out on top around 76, 77.
Right.
They were on the rise to being the biggest band in the world. 78, they peaked. Peter couldn't handle it anymore. He's out. But they kept it going. Dynasty was huge, but boy, you know, it plummeted fast. They did. All bands peak, and all bands are going to, you know, they're going to plummet. Once you've become so big, you got nothing to do. But I mean, some bands will ride the wave, but they couldn't. Their popularity went. And I think what they realized by 1983, you're now in the video age. You got MTV, you got Much Music. You've got all these bands who were out there making videos, and that would have worked for Kiss back in 73 or 75 because they were a visual band. It's ironic that they took the makeup off just at the time that music video for bands was just skyrocketing. But I think that they were struggling. That's the only way I could say it is that they were struggling, and they needed a new identity, and they needed to compete with the Bon Jovis and the Quiet Riots and the Guns N' Roses, and no, not Guns N' Roses.
No.
The Ozzy Osbournes, all the big ones around 82, 83, whoever was big at that time, they had to compete with all them, Whitesnake. It didn't surprise me in the least. Because the thing is, when I was a kid, it was cool. Now I'm in high school. I don't wear my Kiss t-shirt anymore. And I had a buddy who was heading somewhere on an exchange trip, Ontario. Mm-hmm. And I said, could you find me Creatures of the Night? Because I couldn't find it in Newfoundland. And he just laughed at me. He said, I'm not buying you a Kiss record and bringing it back. He didn't want to do that. Mm. All my friends had outgrown Kiss. They just didn't even want to be associated with it. And I think that, you know, if that was happening in a small town in Newfoundland, I think that was happening worldwide.
Sure.
Maybe not in Argentina and Australia, where hysteria was just going huge. But I think in North America, Kiss had had their time. And I think that they were just desperate to redefine themselves. And it, to me, it just made perfect sense.
Yeah, and, you know, it's funny because you talk about, when you look at who was in the band at that time, my theory is, like I said, it was very much a business decision. You mentioned, you know, who they were competing with at that point. Given in 1983. 1983 was actually a very rich rock culture. There was all kinds of, like you said, all kinds of new rock acts that were getting played on the radio. You were starting to get radio stations like in Halifax Q104 for the first time playing really heavy, what I would consider to be heavy music, you know, except, you know, they were playing Rat, they were playing, you know, Twisted Sister, you know, they were playing all this stuff, and that's who they were going to be trying to compete with. Now, I think my theory, well, I have theories too, but I just think it was a natural evolution. Because if, as you said, I think you've accurately captured it. I think they peaked just prior to Dynasty. And I think that, they made a couple of musical mistakes in America. Unmasked was a mistake in terms of the production value of it. The Elder, as much as we think of it today, was really just out there completely. And then they really tried to come back, you know, to be a heavy band again with Creatures of the Night, and it just didn't fly, right? And I think at that point, though, you remember now you're looking at a different dynamic because now you have Eric Carr on drums. Nothing wrong with Eric Carr, but now he's on drums officially, right? And Ace Frehley really, you know, during Creatures of the Night was absent.
No.
Right. I mean,
he didn't record anything on Creatures.
Yeah, I don't think he did he? Because
the only thing on Creatures is his face.
Yeah. So he's gone. So it's sort of like now, you know, what are we going to do? We put they did do the makeup with Vinny, and they did it with Eric. Yeah. And you know, I think that, you know, really, I'm trying to think back. Like, I'll ask you in a second how you felt about it, but when it happened, I remember distinctly when I heard "Lick It Up" for the first time. I know you're sick of the song now. But I remember sitting in the parking lot on Quinpool Road in Halifax waiting for Donna. She was in shopping somewhere, and I had Q104 cranked on the radio.
Yeah.
And that song came on, and I'm going to tell you, when they finally started kicking in that sort of funny, suspended chord or some sort? It's an A augmented.
A flat.
Yeah, but they do an A.
Doesn't matter to me because it's dun 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 dun.
But actually, when they start clicking into the, it actually sounds wicked if you turn it up. But at the time, I remember going, "Whoa, okay." It really kicked me right in the chest. And I thought, okay. And then I saw the video for the first time. And I think that's really important. I mean, if we can show someone that video, I know a lot of people make fun of it a little bit, Jeff, because they say, okay, well, here's Paul, here's Gene, and then
there's... Who are the other guys?
And the guy, and Vinny, I think, was in pink or something like that. But I didn't even care.
Fuzzy pink.
Yeah, yeah, I didn't even care because it was the first time that I saw Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons.
Yes. What was cool. The boys on Three Sides of the Coin had this discussion, and what Mitch LaFon from Montreal had said was, we didn't have MTV, so we didn't get that big unveiling. And I've seen the video. Right. Everyone's seen the video right. since, right? It was a big MTV event.
Right.
But we didn't see that in Canada. So I'll never forget, it was like a Friday night video thing. And I'd really outgrown Kiss. I mean, we were so much into, you know, at that time, 83, yeah, again, Twisted Sister, Rat, Ozzy Osbourne, Quiet Riot, Whitesnake, maybe Bon Jovi. But we were really into that early 80s metal scene. And this Friday Night Videos was on, and they said, and coming up, we've got Kiss for the first time without makeup. And I just... I zeroed right in on that. And the boys knew I was a big Kiss fan.
Yeah. But,
you know, I wasn't going to let on like, oh my God, I'm really shaking here. But I was, and I was at someone else's house, and I'm clinging to the TV. And it's funny, you know, the video, it's directed in such a way that it's almost like the director says, yes, this is the first time we're revealing Kiss.
Yes.
Because if you watch the Lick It Up video, you see their feet.
Yes.
Walking, and you hear the music, you hear Paul,
and the camera goes that. Boom.
And then the camera, and you're looking at feet for quite a while, yes. And you're looking at boots, and
you're thinking, whose boots, whose feet are, whose feet are whose?
Exactly, and you don't get a shot until I think Paul starts singing.
Yeah,
the first verse, and
it's
then
the
you've
chorus.
Got this,
no, it's the chorus.
Yeah, you've got this medium long shot of the. Is it the chorus? Right to the chorus.
It's the chorus. It goes all the way to the chorus,
and it's so obvious who's Paul. I mean, we know Paul Stanley. We're fans.
Yes,
right? It's so obvious who's Gene. I mean, he's the biggest guy. With that
he looks
big
like
face.
Yeah, but he looked like a Neanderthal in that video.
Yeah. So I knew who Vinnie Vincent was because I picked up a magazine and it said his name, and I thought, that's stupid, Vinnie Vincent. That's like calling the guy William Williams. It was just stupid, and this onk. Makeup, and I thought, this is silly. I'm not a Kiss fan anymore. And then I flipped a few pages and read something about Quiet Riot. I don't know. But, and I knew who Eric Carr was. It was easy to tell Eric Carr because this little small face with big hair.
Yeah.
He looked like Eric Carr. I mean, you could tell what these guys look like. Because the first time I saw Ace Frehley without makeup, I said, yeah, it's obviously Ace Frehley. It looks like him.
But that would have been, imagine if that had been the reveal, though. If the reveal had been that's the same time, but it had been all four of them.
If it had been Ace and Peter and Gene and Paul, then that would be that's my boys.
It's still that's my family. But it still had the effect on me of rekindling my interest in them, at least to give them a chance at that point, because I really had fallen off the wagon with Unmasked, The Elder, and Creatures of the Night. So this really, at least it got me. You know, okay, I'm willing to take a look and willing to listen. I actually bought the album, Look It Up. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a few songs on there I like. But most of the album was, like I said, it was a precursor to the 80s stuff that I didn't like so much. But there's a good handful of songs in there. But I think the need to do it, I actually think it was smart at the time because I think if they'd have kept going the way they were, you know, with the current lineup, it was going to continue to go downhill. It was the only thing they could do. And I think they, you know what, at the end of the day, I think they did a good job of it. You know, it was very Kiss-like the way they orchestrated the whole thing. And it had to happen eventually.
It had to happen eventually. And I knew the makeup would come back on. I mean, just the same way Peter and Ace, if you listen to some, you know, mid-90s interviews around the time of the reunion, you know, Peter will say something like, you know, I kind of knew this. I kind of felt that this was going to happen again. I knew in the back of my mind that I'd someday be the Catman again. And you'll hear Ace Frehley saying, I had dreams about doing this. And I just kind of knew that we'd all do this again. And I knew they'd do it again. I knew it's too big to go away completely. That's what I felt in my heart. So when they came out with no makeup on in Lick It Up, I said, yeah, that's it. I just don't need this band in my life anymore. There's so many other good things out there to discover.
Jeez.
Lick It Up.
Pick Pink Floyd, maybe?
Pink Floyd just blew me away in the 80s. Oh, my God. And I thought, this is so interesting, and it's just so much more likable than Lick It Up and All Hell's Breaking Loose.
You're not, you understand, did nothing
for me.
You're not a real fan.
Oh, come on.
No, you're not a real fan. You like the flowery Kiss stuff and you know, the
intro. What can I say? No. But in the back of my mind, I said to myself, you know, I grew up with Kiss as a kid. It's a huge part of my childhood.
Yeah.
They were my favorite band. They'll always be my favorite band. You ask any kid I teach at the high school, right? Who's Mr. Scott's favorite band? Kiss. Well, everyone just knows.
Well, here we are. We're still talking about it. There's all kinds of people talking about it. So, I mean, there's definitely something to it. And I think it was interesting for me because you're right. That was when the video age began, and they jumped on board that. And I remember my interest in them over the decade, you know, the rest of the 80s, was driven by those videos. I bought Lick It Up. I didn't know Animal. I really didn't know when the next albums came out. Like, I knew some of the songs. Like, I knew Heaven's on Fire. I knew some of the songs on Asylum, Today, you know, like Tears Have Fallen and on Crazy Nights and Hot in the Shade was the first one I bought. But the video age without the makeup, you know, so now, okay, so were you watching, like, Donna and I used to watch the videos pretty religiously. Like, they were like, that was a big deal at our house. Like
with that's Saturdays. How you stayed on top of the music. You had to know who was hot. And
yeah.
Oh, the 80s for me are almost defined by what was on the videos. I mean, you know, you take something like just a footnote, Band-Aid.
Yes.
You know, Do They Know It's Christmas? I mean, to me, that's just 1984. That just nails it down. I know exactly the year and what I was doing when I first heard that. You know, Michael Jackson, Thriller. You know, just to throw a few out there. Yeah. I mean, they're just landmark videos. And you know, I can almost relive the 80s by going through my mind some of the videos and what years they came out.
Amongst
those were some Kiss videos.
Right.
And I did take notes. They said, oh, here's Kiss. And I'm like, okay, maybe Peter's going to be back on the drum kit. Maybe Ace is going to be back on guitar. Maybe they've got a new guitar player. Oh, look, they do. That's not Mark St. John. Who's this guy? So, yes, I did follow them, and I did pay attention, but I wasn't buying the albums.
Yeah, I am. It's funny because I'm trying to think. I had definitely gone, my musical interest in the 80s were, you know, I'd already been a Rush fan in the late 70s, but I really went prog rock at that point in my, you know, for my guitar playing and those kind of things. And so, no, having said that, like you said, I remember when the Kiss videos really got my attention, though. Like, when they did it, I think that I have to say, like, well, I know what I think, but what do you think? How do you think their videos compared at the time to the other videos that were being played at the time in terms of entertainment value for you when they came on? And
well, I'll answer that, but first, just a little note on that. Did you notice how in the 80s, pop music has always had different genres? I mean, you got your hard rock and your disco and your flower rock and your folk rock, whatever. But I noticed in the 80s how it really went diverse. I mean, you had your Culture Club and your Duran Duran, and this is what the girls were listening to.
Yeah.
You know, the girls were all Tina Turner, Bruce Springsteen, Culture Club, Duran Duran, and I was all Whitesnake, Quiet Riot, Ozzy Osbourne, Rat, AC/DC, whoever was, you know. And I mean, you'd watch these video hit shows.
Van Halen.
How could I forget Van Halen? I mean, that brought me through the 80s.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, Goodbye Kiss, Hello Eddie. Come on. So to get to your question is, I had to sit through a lot of, you know, this pop fluff, like Men Without Hats and the Thompson Twins. I'm like, oh, come on, give me Poison, give me Rat, give me Motley Crue.
Don't say Poison.
Well, no, okay, Poison.
You can say everything else is okay so far, but don't say Poison or Warrant.
So, how does Kiss compare? You take a video like Men Without Hats. I don't know if you've ever seen that recently.
Of course.
But Safety Dance. It's set like in little village about 200 years ago.
Like the French countryside.
Like the French countryside, and they're all dressed in like little gnomes and elves and whatever.
Yeah.
You don't see a guitar. You see a lute.
Yes.
But you don't see a band. You don't see drums, you don't see a stage, you don't see lights, okay? So a lot of those videos, Think about Yes, Owner of a Lonely Heart.
Yes.
That's like a movie.
Yeah, it is.
You don't see any musicians in that at all.
Right.
All the 80s hair metal guys, all their videos look the same.
It's
shot on a stage.
Yeah,
it's just like you're going to a concert.
That's right.
By Whitesnake, Rat, Poison, Kiss, whomever. It's all shot
all
on a stage.
All kinds of poses.
Poses, you know, the lights going, the fog machine, the audience shots, the girls with the hair,
drummers
and
drummers pointing at the camera,
drummers rolling the sticks.
Yeah.
You know, I can't get my hand in the camera. they all look the same.
They do.
That's something I've pointed out in my music class, because we go through the history of rock and roll, and when we look at the 80s, we look at video and how video affected the music culture, and we looked at how it took that turn from pop music and hair metal. And I say, you know, look at a pop music video, something like Thriller by Michael Jackson, which is like a movie. And then you compare it to, I don't know what I threw on, something by Whitesnake or Poison. And I say, it looks like you're at a concert. And that's the effect they were going for. Now, what's different? Lick It Up is different because it's not done on stage. So that one's a little bit different.
Yeah.
Some of the Van Halen videos were a little bit different.
Yeah.
Something like Hot for Teacher.
Hot for Teacher.
Is like a little movie.
Like my one of my favorite videos of all time.
Oh, it's great. All those teachers. Yeah.
Don't even. But what's
but for the most?
The other Van Halen video is better than that one. That's only better than Finish What You Started. That's the other one. That's Come On, Baby.
Oh, yes.
That one's crazy good. Yeah. Sexist. Very sexy.
Black and white. Lots of models wearing like cowboy hats and slinging their guns. And
yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, but I think I showed my class something by I think it was Poison, Talk Dirty to Me.
Yeah.
And there's not a shot in that video anywhere that's not on a stage.
Yeah,
you know, the whole thing is shot as if you're in the front row watching this concert. And they even show, you know, pictures of the audience screaming and getting into it. And that's the effect that these 80s hair metal bands were going for. And I think Kiss, I can't refer to all the videos, but I think a lot of them were done in that style. It's if it's not live, something like Forever, it's them on a stage with, you don't see the audience, but you certainly see them with instruments. The drummer set up on a big riser behind the band.
Yeah, you're right. And it's like... once they got the Hot in the Shade, they started doing it a little bit different in their videos. Like the video for Hide Your Heart was a story, right?
I don't think I've ever seen that.
It's a very good video, actually. It's a movie of, I don't know what the color is. It's interspersing the band with a video of some subway shots with these, because the story, it follows the storyline, right? Of the Lou Hapless lovers. But you're right. It's funny. I kind of got all caught up in those videos. Like I complain about them now, but I remember I still preferred those metal band videos than to some of the. I guess I was rebelling against the music more than anything else. I really had a hard time with all the 80s keyboard music, that didn't all the digital music, and it really in a real vile way. Now, I listen to it now. I hear it completely different. Like I actually like it. Like I you couldn't get me to go near Human League back in the day. Not a chance. Not a chance in hell. Don't you want me, baby? No way. Not gonna do it. But now I'm flipping through Sirius Radio and I'll come to the channel on the 80s channel and they'll be playing some of that stuff. Mm-hmm. And I have some good memories of that stuff. It certainly is memorable and good pop sensibilities that were there. But for me, the Kiss videos, it was you said it before. What'd you say? It was like the present or the center of the candy, or what? How'd you rephrase it once before? I still. Anytime I got a chance to see those guys, I didn't care. I'd already long given up that it wasn't going to be Peter Criss and Ace Frehley, so I didn't care. I wasn't worried about that too much in the '80s. I was just okay. There they are. Oh, okay, geez, that looks pretty cool. Oh, geez, Paul Danson's kind of funny now.
Mm-hmm.
that's one thing that happened. So let's talk about that. You saw the videos. You didn't listen to a lot of the music in the '80s, right?
No, but like I say, when videos came on, I paid attention,
right?
Because I wanted to see what was happening with this band,
right? So let's take a look at. Okay, now they got the makeup off. We know why they did it, but have you ever watched any of the '80s concert footage?
Little bits on YouTube.
Okay. And you know, what like did you, I, so what did you see? When you watch them,
what did I see? I saw Gene who was Gene who didn't seem to fit the image of a rock star. And I'll compare him to, there's a guy in Twisted Sister. I think he's the bass player. He's huge.
Oh yeah,
he's really big and he's tall, and he just doesn't seem to fit. Because, you know, like, I mean, if you look at Eddie Van Halen as the yardstick by which you measure, you know, these 80s pop stars, you know, not overly huge, you know, slender, kind of fun to look at, you know, he's pleasant looking, but the long hair and the moves and whatever. And you can compare a lot of people to him. You can compare Randy Rhoads. You can compare Paul Stanley. You can compare, you know, a lot of people to that. Gene just didn't seem to fit. He fit as the demon, but he's just this big, and he's not portraying himself like he was with the makeup on. And of course, you know, whether it's Bruce on guitar or Vinny on guitar or Mark St. John on guitar, I don't really care. To me, they're all the same thing. Drummer who really notices a drummer. Drummer's behind a big set of drums, and Eric's kind of small anyway. Yeah. So it's like, you know, he sees his little face peeking out over a tom-tom. Paul was the perfect front man. I mean, to me, he blended right in with anyone. You know, like lead singer of Whitesnake. God, I can't even think of these people anymore.
He still had a good voice then, right?
Yeah, you could compare him to Bon Jovi. You could compare him to David Coverdale. Yeah. You could compare him to David Lee Roth. Any of those big people in the 80s, Paul fit right in.
Yeah.
So to me, Kiss was in the 80s was, yeah, Paul Stanley, he holds up against any of those guys. Who's on guitar, I don't care. Who's on drums, I don't care. Gene doesn't seem to fit.
Right.
And that's just the way I saw it.
Well, that's cool. But, you know, I guess what I saw when I look at those concert videos, I didn't see a lot of them at the time. So I thought the music, obviously, firstly, the 80s music was, to me, was an overcompensation to try and compete with, you know, the Eddie Van Halen, for one, and all the speed guitar work that was going on. Now, yeah. Coincidentally, at the same time that that's going on, Metallica is building a following. Iron Maiden, right, are building a following.
Okay? That's where I went.
But those guys are all, but they were really still a cult status at that point, right? They really weren't huge yet. So, because I remember I was over, when was it? It was 1982, I think it was, and I was over at the university, and this guy tried to get me to listen to Number of the Beast. And I couldn't stand it. And
Number of the Beast is not my favorite Maiden. There's two albums before that.
Yeah, I know you do.
That there's Paul. Material on that. Paul Di'Anno.
Yeah.
Freaking awesome singer.
So
I love those albums.
You know what? I like that. Maybe we should have a channel for Iron Maiden too, because I'm a big fan. But but what I saw was musically they were trying to overcompensate for the lack of the show and lack of the makeup. Yes. Yeah. So let's think about it. You drop the show. You don't have, you know, I don't even know if Gene live did the fire, but he must have still done the fire.
I think he still did the fire.
But they lost.
I don't think he did the blood.
Yeah, you're right. He didn't do the
and
blood.
And I think they had lots. I think they were still doing some pyro.
Yeah.
I think if anything, they probably beefed up their stage.
Well, they started to, well, the stage itself, but I really think that the 80s were marked by them overcompensating for not having the makeup on. When you watch the way they come out and their movements on stage.
Paul's definitely overcompensated.
Well, so is Gene. If you look at
he doesn't have those boots on him. I don't know. I haven't seen enough of it to see what Gene is doing.
Pull some up and let's show some of that, okay? Because you're going to see, and people have talked about this before. Some guy said on YouTube, it's a funny comment. He said, "Ah, yes, the aerobics age," right? Because that's what they look like. They look like they were coming out. Okay, everybody, and then they go 1, 2, 3, 4, and they're like flying everywhere over the stage. Like Gene is back and forth. He's doing all these cliche poses and his feet are moving all over the place. Paul's dancing all over the place. I'm thinking, you know what? You think about the coolest pictures you saw at Kiss in the 70s. It's when they were doing those static poses. Mm-hmm. It's when they were like the three of the, like the best picture I ever saw of them is when there's the three of them, their legs intertwined, all bending in different directions, guitars raised, flames going up, and Peter Criss with his hands over his head in the background.
Yes, right? I know the one you're talking about. Exactly.
But their static poses, they were grooving to the music. They weren't just running all over the place with their heads cut off.
Their stages were so much bigger in the 80s.
They were. And I think
they used the entire width of a stadium.
Well, that's all they had.
And it's just a lot of running.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't say running in the 70s.
No, you're right. You didn't. Not much. I'm trying to think if there's anybody. Well, Rick Emmett maybe from Triumph.
He runs too. Iron Maiden, they do a lot of running.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is about 80s metal bands. They run on stage.
Well, that was how their stage moves. Like Tommy Thayer does traditional. He does this little jog over to the microphone. Like there's this. I thought about that. I've never actually tried that move. The metal players semi-run to the microphone. I got to practice that sometime. But seriously, there's a move that these guys do that's like a sort of casual jog over to the microphone when you're going to go sing when you're going to pretend to sing background vocals.
And come in just a little bit late.
Yes, always, of course.
I hate, you know, something. I've got a problem with live recordings, and my problem with that is I hate it when they're trying to make it sound different and they're just playing with the rhythm.
Yeah.
And it's fatiguing to listen to because in the studio, it has a rhythm. It has a rhythm because you wrote a song. The rhythm matches the music. Now you're live. And it's like, you know, how late can I come in and still get all the words in? And can I take this line and you know, add an extra word?
Right, right.
You know, it's like, I don't know. I can't think of an example. But Kiss have done it. Not a whole lot. I like their live albums because they are somewhat true to the studio recordings. If anything, just more energy.
Yeah.
But I just don't like it when someone totally messes a vocal line to the point where it becomes something completely different.
Well,
it's fatiguing to listen to.
Well, it's funny you mention that because I know we'll probably have a blood battle someday on this song. Look it up between you and I. But Paul changes that live. And he makes it. He changes the cadence of the vocal, and it really is nowhere near as good as the original version of it. And they also play with. They don't have the patience in the song to let the quiet moments between verses stay. Mm-hmm. They got to put extra stuff in there, right? And it is simple, but it's meant to be simple, and that's where sometimes the best rock songs are. I mean, my gosh, they're so simple, but. Yeah. I think I saw the 80s, and like I said, we should find some video and show some of that, of them running around the stage, because I really just see that as a big overcompensation for, or you know, they're just not confident yet in themselves, and I can understand that. I mean, imagine if it was, you know, let's put ourselves in their shoes, and now they've come out of being the greatest rock band in the land with their makeup on, and now they're out there essentially naked. And
blending in with every other hair metal band of the 80s. Yeah. I mean, they were totally unique. I mean, the only thing you could compare them to in the 70s was Cooper, David Bowie, maybe.
Not even close, really.
No. I mean, now, you know, you can compare them to every other hair metal band that's out there.
Yeah.
So.
And I think.
And to me, none of those hair metal bands were exciting. I mean, okay, look, if you want to go back to, you know, 82, 83, I kind of grew out of Kiss, but that didn't bother me none because there was a whole slew of new stuff like Rat, Twisted Sister, Quiet Riot, Ozzy Osbourne, Blizzard of Oz, great album, Randy Rhoads.
What'd you think
man, that stuff was exciting. But, you know, coming out of that into the mid, later 80s, I really wasn't taking notice of it. And that's around the time of Metallica. And I didn't like Metallica at all. I just like metal, and there's just so many other cool things to discover. But Iron Maiden was always one of my favorites, and I followed them.
What'd you think of... So obviously Motley Crue kind of tailored themselves after Kiss.
Didn't like Motley Crue. To me, that was just bad rock. And I know there's a lot of huge Motley Crue fans.
Oh, I like Crue. I like the Crue
I'm surprised, but, you know...
That's early stuff though.
Yeah.
And they
but it turned me off from the start. I just didn't care for this. And you know, they were Kiss imitators with their war.
They had
their
little
leather.
Things on there. They got rid of that pretty quick though.
It's like if you're gonna do makeup. You wanna be Kiss?
But I'll tell you what, I saw they did a tour of Australia with Kiss there a few years back. And you watch their show compared to Kiss's show, and they were kicking Kiss's ass all over the place.
Oh, probably. And they, no doubt there's good players in there. Just that first material that came out.
It's not. They did nothing for me.
They're
worse musicians than... They're not great musicians by a long shot. You know, Tommy's a, you know, adequate drummer. What's his name? Nikki Six on bass is... He had to learn how to play bass. He was very much a guy who said, I want to put a band together. Now I'll learn how to play bass. And then, seriously, Mick Mars was the only guy that could play. And he's a really good songwriter, rhythm guitar player, but his lead guitar playing is very much Nigel Tufnel material. Sometimes, right? You know, remember the lead solo Nigel Tufnel does, and he's playing all this fast stuff on the guitar, and it makes no sense whatever. Then he takes the violin out and plays
the violin.
And he turns the strings on the violin and starts playing.
He turns the violin.
Yeah. But that's what Mick Mars reminds me of, his lead guitar playing. But this is what Kiss is compared. You know, this is all this. This is where it's coming to. So, but I think that.
If you just want to get into the lead solos in the 80s.
Yeah.
I mean, they were all trying to be Van Halen.
Oh my God.
And I think Van Halen was trying to be Randy Rhoads. Now, if you want to look at the 80s, look at that whole ocean and sea of lead players. Okay?
Yeah.
You can include Mick Mars and whomever. To me, it was only two. There's Randy Rhoads and Eddie Van Halen. And I think where Eddie Van Halen has such a bigger body of work, I think Van Halen would certainly have to come out on top. But
yeah.
I'm in the car and I've got Boneyard on, and something will come on with Randy Rhoads. And I mean, I'm just in the middle of Mr. Crowley or Over the Mountain or something. And I'm thinking, oh my God, Eddie doesn't hold a candle to Randy Rhoads. I think, you know, people talk about the day the music died and the death of John Lennon. And, you know, I feel sad for any of these people, but my God, I think the loss of Randy Rhoads is one of the biggest tragedies in rock music, in my heart. And I play a 74 white Les Paul Custom just because I think Randy was a much better player than anyone and a much bigger influence than even Ace Frehley to me. So, you know, I'm a huge Randy at heart.
I can't really say. I mean, I didn't really pay that much attention to what he was doing. And I paid attention to Van Halen up to a point. And once it became Van Hagar, I still listened to it, but it became much more poppy for me. And the guitars became less of a, but you know, but Eddie was special. He is special. He's not dead. So
I like the fact that, you know, you were talking about that song, Come On Baby, Finish What You Started.
That's awesome guitar work.
What I love about that is he stopped being that over-the-top whiz Van Halen and started doing something really cool. It's like a clean Strat sound.
But try
bluesy.
Playing it.
Oh no!
I mean,
I'd have to sit down with a tab and learn that.
The technique on that song—it's not actually not hard to play, but the technique on that song is to get.
It's very slappy, isn't it?
Yes, it's really cool. I learned how to play a little bit of it for a while there, and I never finished learning it. It's not too bad, really, but that just goes to show you. But I'm going way off topic now. So if you look at the Kiss in the 80s and we talked about this too, we may as well do a little bit of that because they went through a period there. I didn't realize this. I was reading today that Animal Eyes sold better than Lick It Up, and I think it sold better than Asylum and Crazy Nights. And then I did think they were starting to dig themselves out of the hole with Hot in the Shade and Revenge. And
I saw these albums in the store and I thought,
The only
thing that tells me it's a Kiss record
video.
Is there's a Kiss logo on it. But
video's
gone. Hot in the Shade. I mean, an Egyptian Sphinx wearing a pair of sunglasses.
See, we're backwards that way. See, I saw the video of Hide Your Heart.
Yeah.
And that sucked me in because I really liked that song. I liked their version of that song.
I don't think I've ever seen. I've never seen that. I know I haven't seen.
Well, you got to show a little bit of that too because that's a really good. It's XX. I think it's a really good video and it's a very simple song. Blair and I play that song all the time, and it's a fun song. It's got a real good hick to it. Ace Frehley covered it, right? He did it as well on I think.
Trouble. That's right. I think Ace did the same song at the same time.
Yeah, I think I think it was on Trouble Walking. I think.
Yeah.
Is the album that's on Ace's solo album there. Well, Frehley's Comet album.
And, so which one do you prefer?
The Kiss version. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I do. It's because of the vocal, I think. And yeah. But I think Kiss did a really good job of that song. Some people would look at that album and call it, you know, it's a bunch of demos, but every album is a bunch of demos. Right at some point, and it's just a question of how you put it together. But that one with the
Hey Jude was a demo when it first came out.
There you go.
I mean, any great song has to be a demo at some point.
Exactly. but I got in the Hot in the Shade because of that video. It sucked me in. So, so the covers came way after that for me. But so yeah. I asked you this a while ago, we may as well bring it up now because we're looking at about how long are we into this now? About
44 minutes.
44 minutes. So,
yeah.
I have a theory. Right.
Oh,
and I want.
There's a lot of theories going around tonight.
Well, that's okay. This is my turn to have a theory. So I have something that I think, and I think this will rile a few people up. But I would argue that Dynasty was Kiss's last great album.
You say that a lot. Yeah.
I
that's not the first time you've said that. Come on, give me something new.
No, because we've never discussed it in public.
We've bounced around that topic, just the two of us.
But we've never really saw it through to fruition, right? So my thought process on this was this. And then, you know, because I know there's people that are going to give me grief for this. Because they're going to say Revenge is a great album. And they're going to say that, well, there's even some people that are going to say Monster is a great album. But my theory on this, when I call it a great album, and I told you this much, is that when you look at an album that you can't throw away more than two songs,
I know what you mean.
A great album to me is and I don't even think it's a great album. To be honest with you, if you're throwing away two, if you're throwing away one, it would be a great album. But if any more than two, I certainly can't see it being a great album, especially when they were only doing 10 songs an album, right?
Yeah.
So I said that, right? Of course, you probably agree with me. No, you won't agree with me.
Well, I'm going to agree with you, but I'm going to put another spin on it.
You can't agree with me.
I can agree with you.
No, you can't.
Why?
Because you love the Elder too much. No, seriously.
The Elder's not a great Kiss album, and then I'll tell you, the Elder.
All right.
No, I'll explain to you why, and then we'll put the Elder in a different perspective.
Okay.
Here's what Dynasty is for me. It was the summer of 79.
Yeah.
Kiss were the biggest things in our life.
Yeah.
It was. Not just me, the guys I hung around with.
Right.
And I was on vacation in the United States, and I came home with the 45 of, excuse me, I have a really itchy nose tonight. It's driving me nuts. But anyway, I came home with the 45 of I Was Made for Loving You, and I said, they've got a new album. Now, we didn't see this in Newfoundland for months. It had been out for quite a while.
Right.
But we were just so gaga over Kiss, and there was a new record store opening, and then they built a new mall. They had a new record store opening. Long story short, they were advertising for weeks in the paper, and Kiss Dynasty was one of the albums they had on special. We waited like you wouldn't believe. This is in August. The album came out in May, but we didn't have it until the store opened. But when we got it, my God, we played it endlessly. And for me, it was the last bit of Kiss-steria for me as a kid, because none of us were excited about Unmasked at all, like we were excited about Dynasty. I mean, I had it on record. Another guy had it on 8-track, and he had a battery-powered 8-track player. And we pitched in our money and bought D batteries, and we used to hang out in this, we hung out in the playground. After all the little kids were gone, we'd go to this playground, and we'd swing, and we'd go down the slides, and whatever. That was our hangout until the cops chased us out. And my buddy Dave had a battery-operated 8-track player, and he bought a Dynasty on 8-track, and we used to go up there, and, I mean, we sang every song at the top of our lungs. And then we'd have these parents yelling at us, you know, like, get out of there, go home.
But, freaks, I mean, you freaks!
Yeah, but, I mean, that was such a cool summer. I'll never forget it as long as I live. Mm-hmm. No one bought Unmasked except me. Mm-hmm. And when Elder came around, it's like I bought the thing and I didn't want anyone to see me bringing the album home. So I made sure it was well bagged. And if I met a friend of mine on the road coming home, they said, what record did you buy? I say, oh, it's just an Ozzy Osbourne album.
It's not a record.
I'll call you later and tell you about it. It's not a record.
It's a bottle of vodka. It's a bottle of vodka. It's a Playboy magazine and a bottle of vodka.
So when you talk about the last great Kiss album, for me, it was the last great Kiss experience with an album.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes any sense.
It does. It does make perfect sense. And so when I go through, and that's what I do, the way I look at it now, don't get me wrong, I'm saying the last great Kiss album. I'm not saying that there aren't other good albums. I'm saying that...
And I'm agreeing with you because of the way you talk about the great number of great songs on it. And yes, the music is great. And from my perspective, it's from the experience as well as the music. But I know what you mean by the music, you know, having great songs on that album.
Because it's well, I went through it, and I guess for me, I rediscovered it recently, right? I mean, because it was my last foray into Kiss as well, really, until I picked, you know, I kind of lost track of them for a while until Lick It Up, and then, but nothing ever after that point, nothing really completely engaged me all the way through. And Unmasked, to this day, I've never been able to really get into it. I mean, I can appreciate some of a couple of the Ace Frehley tunes on there, but that's about it. The Elder, like we've already had this conversation, it took me almost 40 years to appreciate that record. I do now, but at the time, definitely not a great Kiss album. Creatures of the Night, there's some good songs on that that I like. I like the song Creatures of the Night. I like War Machine. I like I Love It Loud. Which I know you maybe don't like those songs, but there's a few songs.
I don't like War Machine. I don't like I Love It Loud. Do you know what I really like? I like Crazy Nights.
Ugh.
I like the song Crazy Nights. I've heard that a few times in the last year or so, and I thought, I like that. If they did that in the concert, I'd be, yeah, this is cool. But they won't.
They did. Well, I thought they did that in one of the recent sets. I thought they did it in Australia in one of the sets.
They could have.
They take a look.
You know, they'll do something very different. Like, look at the Kiss Cruise.
Yeah.
That set list was really different.
Yeah.
And it's because they know they've got diehards on that ship. And they want to do what diehards want to hear.
Yes.
Which brings me to my theory. And I don't think we have enough time to get into it. But in 30 words or less, I think that anyone who goes to a Kiss show is either one of two things. Or either a diehard or the diehard's girlfriend. And the diehard's girlfriend isn't going to know... You know, Black Diamond from Jumpin' Jack Flash. So
right.
And cater to the diehards anyway.
There's a whole bunch.
Because they're going to be in the audience.
There's a whole bunch of fans there now, who are, how do I call them? They're sort of it's a fad, right? So it's like they're older fans. They know one or two Kiss songs. They might know Love Gun, Rock and Roll All Night, but they go there for the isn't this cool? And they know how to do their hands like this, right? Yep. And they stick their tongues out, and they might even put the makeup on. But they couldn't name more than two Kiss songs. But it's a cool thing to do. And if you sat down with them, they wouldn't have any of the Kiss records at home. It's like going to the play for them. Or going to the circus, really.
That's what happened in Newfoundland two summers back. They played the Salmon Festival in Grand Falls, Windsor, Newfoundland. And
smoked salmon?
It could be smoked salmon. Well, salmon smoke, you know.
Pate? Salmon pate?
Yeah. So anyway, 20,000 people came out to see that. And I thought, I don't think there's 20,000 Kiss fans in Newfoundland. And I mean, I had to set myself apart. I went in full... boots, makeup, and costume. I thought, you know, I'm going to... And there weren't many, I'll tell you. When I went to Montreal, there was a lot of people in costume and makeup. But this thing in Newfoundland, I stuck out like a sore thumb. It was easy to find me in a crowd.
Yeah.
So that was probably one of the few people wearing makeup.
But they... it was... what were we talking about?
I don't know.
You got me out. You went completely sideways. Oh, your theory on the set list and the music.
I don't care if we go over an hour, but I want to keep it to an hour. But I just had a couple of things in the back of my mind that I wanted to bring up. Well, getting back to the topic of taking off the makeup in 83.
Yeah.
In 30 words or less, a timeline for myself, okay? In 78, I'm a huge Kiss fan. 79, I'm still a huge Kiss fan. In 1980, there's this talk of I guess it was a rumor talk. I mean, this is before the internet and Twitter, but it was common knowledge that Peter was on his way out,
right.
And that hurt me. It did, because Kiss was something so special to me as a kid, and I didn't want to see that break up. I mean, to me, it was like, you know, your mom and dad breaking up, and I don't know. It was just it just didn't jive with me at all. And then when they brought in Eric Carr, I thought, well, that's it. It's final. Peter is gone. My favorite band is no longer my favorite band.
Mm-hmm.
There are now three of my favorite band with someone else. So, I mean, I never was really a big Eric fan. I was growing away from the band. Then Ace Frehley leaves, and they bring in Vinnie Vincent. At that point in time, I thought, I don't know. So I was only a half a Kiss fan. And then when the makeup came off completely, it was, to me, it was 100% gone. Mm-hmm. It really was. Mm-hmm. So that's just a, it was a gradual thing. Peter, then Ace, then the makeup. Once the makeup went, to me, it wasn't Kiss at all. I mean, they still hold the name. Yes, they can perform under the name Kiss because legally they can. But to me, it's like, you know, going to see the Cats on Broadway, and no one's wearing a cat uniform or cat makeup. They're just doing the dances and singing the songs. Yeah. That to me, that's what it is. It was about the makeup and about the theatrics. So and I lost. This is what doesn't make sense. It does, but it doesn't. I lost all interest in the band's music. Did I ever think for 1 minute that these guys recorded their songs in makeup? No. I know that they don't record in makeup. They record, you know, in their jeans and their t-shirts, the same as anyone would. Yeah, so does the makeup pre-83, is that more special because it's the makeup era? No one ever recorded music with makeup on. Even Kiss Alive, a lot of that was done in the studio.
Yeah.
You know, so
your 30 seconds is way up, by the way.
I know. I'm sorry. I got long-winded.
Well, it's the first time for everything.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
Well, I get you, though. I get you. But I think, so what, so someone recently said.
I don't know which side you're on. Bang, bang.
You said, the other day we were talking, and you said, half a Kiss is okay.
Yeah.
And someone said,
"Is
any Kiss better than no Kiss?"
Mitch LaFon said,
"Don't go there.
Any Kiss is better than no Kiss."
Well, he just made. I don't know if it was a statement or a question. He had a period.
Maybe
there,
he was just quoting it. But yeah, I mean, I'm going to see Kiss this summer. I know it's only Paul and Gene, and I know that Paul can't pull off what he used to pull off. So he's relying on Gene and the others to create a show. But yeah, I'm gonna go because, you know, I'm a Kiss fan and. I'm a fan of the music, and I know they're going to play a lot of classic Kiss, which I want to hear. And to me, it's better than sitting around at home.
Well, yeah, but you're going to be prepared to see them twice.
I may do that. Mm-hmm. They're playing two nights in Atlantic Canada, so I may do a little road trip.
And I may have a ticket for you.
Well, that'd be great.
Yeah, well,
because you know what I'm going to do. See here, we've got sort of like a little barbecue thing planned at a friend's house.
Yeah.
And like two summers ago, they were begging me to put on this costume.
Right.
I didn't want to.
No.
I didn't want to wear the costume. I was just in my shorts and t-shirt. I just wanted to go down and enjoy the show.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's saying, oh, you got to wear the costume. You came all this distance. You brought that costume on a Newfoundland ferry. You have to wear it. You have to.
I only
bought a ticket just to see you in a costume. So, I mean, I felt like I had to do it. Now, this summer, when we go to the one in St. John, I think I'll just go in a Kiss t-shirt. But in Halifax, I'm more likely to put on the costume.
Well, you can stay.
No one's gonna know me.
You can stay at our house, and
definitely.
You can stay at our house, and you can use our mirrors and whatnot to do that. So, because I'm pretty sure Donna's not gonna go, but no. I guess. But are you
going?
Well, you know what? That's the question. Is like I'm gonna.
Come on!
I gotta be careful because I watched a video the other day of Paul singing "Hell or Hallelujah." It's not one of my favorite.
What? That's not even a Kiss song.
Well, it is a Kiss song. So
no, it's not.
It's a
monster song.
So even at that though, I mean, it was painful to watch, and so I'm really, I don't know. I have a real problem with someone coming out saying we're the greatest band in the world, and portraying that, you know, we're the hottest band, the greatest band in the world, and then not delivering on that. I think the fans. Well, I think they get a free ride sometimes from the fans, and just because, you know, because of the show. And anyway, that's that. So I have a problem. You know, I have a problem with it, and I do continue to have a. And this is my personal issue. I do have a bit of a problem with watching other people in the makeup. I don't have a problem with the players, but I have a problem with the makeup thing. And it does bother me for some reason, and I apologize to anybody that doesn't, but for some reason it does bother me. So I got a couple things going on in my head right now. That one, I really am concerned about how am I going to feel. You showed me those photos the other day from 1977,
mm-hmm.
and I remember how I felt after that concert and how I felt ever since that time. And I'm really worried that I'm going to ruin it by going to see a substandard performance.
Yeah, I can agree with you there. My Kiss concert was 2000. It was the farewell tour. I had such a great seat. I wasn't on the floor. I was in the bowl. But my God, I was so close to Ace Frehley. It was, you know, my God was 30 feet away from me. Yeah. And they did all my favorite Kiss. I mean, they just, you know, the reunion tour, I didn't have a good seat at all. And I just, you know, it was a thrill to see them for the first time.
Yes.
I remember saying, oh my God, I'm in the same room with my heroes, you know, and that was the thrill.
Right, right.
But the reunion tour was the concert. I mean, my God, it was just friggin' amazing. And I went to the one in Newfoundland thinking the exact same thing. Is this going to tarnish my experience, that 2000 concert? But it's not, because it was a completely different thing. First of all, I was outside in the rain.
Right.
I knew it wasn't Ace. I knew it wasn't Peter. Mm-hmm. But you know something? I you know, I've met Eric and I've met Tommy, and I like Eric. I don't really care for Tommy. That, you know, I guess he's okay. But that's not the point.
He didn't look you in the eye.
No, he wouldn't look me in the eye when he was talking to me. Eric was a sweetheart. Eric talked to me and he signed everything, and he was just cool. Really nice guy.
Right.
So I knew it wasn't the original boys, but you know, even when everyone else left the stage and it was just the Eric and Tommy show, it was cool. It was really cool. It was pyro, and it was guitar, and it was drums, and smoke. And I thought, you know, the spirit is here, if anything. So I don't know. I kind of agree with you, and I kind of don't, Jeff. I don't know.
Well,
don't
no,
what
it's
say.
Just no. You know what? I don't know.
Go, look,
I
just go see it, and then decide.
Well, yeah, but then I'll screw it all up, right? If I go see it. So my problem is this: I can deal. I bought the tickets knowing that. Look, all more power to people. If they're getting something out of the band today, great. I'm not going to knock that, not at all. I'm just saying, for me, it's a problem, and you know, and I'm not going to call and say anybody else is wrong, but you know, to say that my problem is that Paul's voice is so bad now.
Yeah.
It's painful for me to watch it. I feel bad for him. I feel embarrassed for him. I would be embarrassed if I was them. As a musician who can't sing or play anywhere near as good as they can, I would be embarrassed to portray that, you know, when that happens, and just to ignore it. So anyway, that's my fear. But I'll deal with that. I'll get some therapy. And I'll probably still end up going. And but I'll be honest with you, I'm mostly going to be going because you and Blair will be there. And if it
yeah,
wasn't,
I mean, it's,
I skipped
it's,
them when they came through the last time.
It's the East Coast Kiss tribute reunion, is what it is.
Yeah.
Well, what better way to celebrate a reunion than going to a Kiss show?
Well, I agree. We'll have to have a concert of our own, and then we'll tie it into that somehow. And you know what would be really cool? So what I think would be really cool is if we busked the show outside.
Now that's a damn good idea.
Acoustic guitars and like a get Blair to get a little bongos or something like that, and do a bunch of Kiss songs for people as they're going in.
Yeah, but you know what happened?
What?
Well, you'd have Doc McGee coming outside asking for royalties.
I don't think
that's exactly
think
what's going to happen.
I think, or do it somewhere near there, right? And then just do, you know, and then but then have someone pick up the stuff, and we can go to the show, right?
Mm-hmm.
That'd be cool. You know, you'd have fans jumping in on that, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, see, I always saw myself before internet sales, you know, when you have those lineups, you're camping out for tickets.
Yeah.
So I always saw myself, like, I always knew Kiss would come to Harbor Station someday. I don't know why, but I just know these things. I'm psychic. And I thought, it's going to be so cool when they play Harbor Station someday. I'm going to be camped out, because we camped out for Neil Young tickets. And I didn't even care. I just wanted to camp out with some cool guys who were playing Neil Young songs all night long.
Right.
So I said, we'll be playing Kiss songs. Because I'll just bring a guitar and I'll just start playing, and people will join in, and we'll have this big, huge Kiss jam.
Yeah. I think
so. I kind of saw myself doing that.
I think it's a good idea. I think
it is. Yeah, it is. Especially if we have makeup on.
Well, Blair can't wear the makeup, right?
No?
No, his skin will get irritated. He can't wear it. But the last question you asked, and we dealt with this before, like, for me, you know, definitely not the case that any Kiss is better than no Kiss. I think that's a really bad way to look at things, in my opinion. I don't think anything of anything is better than nothing sometimes, and the classic way of looking at that is a bad marriage better than no marriage. And
I saw those, and I see where you're coming from there.
It's just, well, no, I mean, there's something. I mean, I'm being overdramatic, but just to say, as a matter of fact, that any kiss is better than no kiss. No, because for me, bad kiss damages the way I think about them.
And it
ruins my memories of them. Mm-hmm. And my memories are very fleeting because I don't have as many as some. Like, I know, like, for some people, they may have seen them 30, 40, 50, 100 times. But I've got the one time, and I really don't want to screw that up. But anyway. No.
But you're going to see a different show.
I know. You know what? It'll be interesting, but I just have to squint and make funny faces when Paul's singing and try not to let that bother me.
You know, in the Newfoundland show in 2011, it wasn't far into the show, and Paul went to the microphone and he let out this big squeal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, "Hello, Newfoundland!"
Yeah.
And then a big "Wow!"
Yeah.
But when he did that, it's like something broke.
Yeah.
You know, it's like when you bend a string too far,
and then
you know, you just popped your E string, right? Yeah. I said, "Holy frig, Paul. So early in the show to do that."
Well,
and I said, like, something, this is before his surgery, by the way, something snapped, something broke, something popped, and I could hear it. And anyway, partway through a song, and I think it was a Paul song, might have been Strutter or something,
mm-hmm.
he's got his back to the audience. He's looking at the band. And I thought, like, you know, I know Kiss on stage. And I said, there's something different about this. Mm-hmm. So it's like he's making eye contact with Eric.
Yes.
As if to say, you know, look at my face. Look at me. I'm looking at you. I'm giving you a signal. Okay? Something's not right here. I think he was looking for Eric to back him up.
Right.
From that moment on, he just wasn't singing at all. And during Dr. Love, he disappeared completely. I mean, mm-hmm. they could pull off Dr. Love without Paul. He was gone completely off the stage. Maybe to drink some lemon tea or something, I don't know. But he wasn't the same, and Gene Simmons carried the show.
And
I wonder if they might have even altered the set on the fly and put more Gene songs in. I'm not sure.
I must say this. Other than Gene's Weeble That Wobbles thing that he does, he's got this thing that he does now that bugs the heck out of me. He does this kind of thing like this. He goes like this back and forth. And it looked but it looked cool when he was skinny. But now when he's wide, it looks like he's a weeble that's turned a wobble. And it doesn't look cool anymore. But I got to say,
that's funny.
But I got to say, you know, his bass playing is still, you know, he's a top-notch Kiss, he's a top-notch rock bass player, and you know what? He sings the same as he always did. He was never a live singer, but he has never lost whatever it is he had. It's still the same, and you know, gotta give him credit for that. He sticks to it a lot more. I was thinking about that today. I think he stuck to the band a lot more than I thought he would after watching some of the Family Jewel show, and he's very dedicated to the band, so I got to give him credit for that. And, so we're just getting over an hour there, buddy.
Yeah. Just want to mention something you said. You said Gene rarely looks at his hands when he's playing.
Right.
And, you know, I never really thought of it, but, you know, I've seen a lot of Kiss footage, and I've got my favorite Kiss footage, and you're right. He doesn't look at his hand.
You know who told me that?
Blair told me that.
Yeah.
He plays bass lines, and he knows exactly where his hand is.
Yep.
And you just don't see him looking down. He's really focused on the audience.
He. I think if you watched him do the same song, like say Deuce, mm-hmm. at 50 concerts, and you put them side by side by side, I bet you you'd see that at each point in the song, he does almost identically the same motions with his hands, his facial expressions, which direction he looks in. All mm-hmm. those things, he's got it down to a bit of a, what do you call it,
what's a habit word? I guess.
Well, it's a routine. It's definitely a routine. Mm-hmm. So, but he's and you know what, they do lots of little, now mind you, the runs that they do on the bass tend to be fairly box shaped in the sense that mm-hmm. they're you know, you can find them without looking. You could probably play them in the dark.
Yeah,
I was telling.
But you know, even some of the simplest songs I play on guitar, I look down just to see if my hand is where it should be.
I look more than I look when I'm singing more than I do when I'm playing. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was talking to, it's funny, I was talking to Christine Vitale the other day. Mm-hmm. Vitale. And,
from New York.
From Jersey, actually.
Jersey. From Jersey.
From Jersey. And we were talking about music somehow, and it came up, and we were talking about, I was telling her about the times where you and I used to jam in your living room, and you had that old fretless bass.
Yes.
And the difference in playing a fretless bass and playing a regular bass, and how precise you have to be with a fretless. Right. And anyway, that just it was very much going off in the left field now, maybe right field if you look at the wrong way on the screen. But anyway, the he's a great bass player. But so there you go. There's the discussion about the makeup. And I think the next discussion should be probably about the reunion.
Yes. Yeah.
That was your definitely idea. Right?
Well, just as a sort of a tail end of this and leading up to that.
Yes.
For me, I had a bit of a KISS renaissance. I mean, I certainly grew out of KISS in the 80s, and we've been through all that tonight, and how, you know, Peter left, Ace left, the makeup came off, I'm done with it. I jumped ship big time. There were so many other exciting things to discover in the 80s, and KISS just wasn't one of them for me. When I started teaching school around 92, you know, for the first time I had some money and I had my own apartment and just discovering some new things. And I was at a yard sale and I picked up the first KISS album on a cassette. And I thought, gosh, I haven't heard this in years. I mean, I went through that whole 80s thing where it's just not cool to listen to KISS anymore. And it just wasn't even exciting to listen to KISS anymore. So I got this thing at a yard sale for 50 cents and I brought it home and I'm playing it and I'm really hearing it with fresh ears. And the production on that album, I really think, is one of the better produced albums. There was some really cool stuff done with the guitar, and they were playing really well as well. And at that time, KISS became kind of retro. So I remember going into a magazine store, and here was a guitar magazine that was dedicated to KISS, and it had them on the front cover in makeup. And I thought, this is kind of like the 70s, you know, and you could buy KISS magazines. It was a magazine all about KISS. So I bought this magazine, brought it home, and I was playing that first KISS album. I thought, oh man, this is like being a kid again. So around 92 or 93, I had this personal KISS renaissance, and it just took off from there, because what happened next was Kiss My Ass. Mm-hmm. And if you look inside Kiss My Ass, it says Ace and Peter, we never forget what the four of us created so many years ago. We miss you. And I said, now, and I always said I had this premonition that they were going to reunite. I knew that. I just knew that I was going to have my moment watching Kiss, the original Kiss with the makeup. I knew that.
Well, let's talk.
So that was a clue. The next one was, and we've talked about this in an earlier show, was when they did Unplugged. And Peter rose his arms. He said, me and the boys will be playing all night. The look on Gene's face said it all. Gene said, look, these fans want this. And when they came out at the Grammys in makeup, I said, I knew that. I could have told you that back in 92, that they were going to get back together. So I had my renaissance in 92, and it just took off from there. And the reunion in 96, it was just, everything just fell into place for this KISS fan sitting right here.
Right on. So, you know, and we'll talk about that, because, and that's where we should start. I'd like us to start with when you and I met. Because when I met you,
95,
yeah,
and it was right around the time of Unplugged.
Yeah, it was before Unplugged. It was around Kiss My Ass, because we were sharing that together. I remember that, because but I remember with Kiss My Ass, I remember you were very much a Kiss fan at that point in time. You got me back.
That was my renaissance.
Well, you got me back into it at that point.
I got you back into it.
Yes.
Because, no.
Yes, you did. And,
yeah.
And cool. Oh yeah, for sure. Like, I would have been away from it, and then got back into it when you were there, and then I again got back into it again when I came back to Halifax quite a few years later when I ran into Blair and we started doing stuff together. So let's do that next time, and let's start with that point in our, where we got together, and that'll lead us right into the reunion for sure.
Well, playing acoustic guitar was a nightmare.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll never forget that. I'll never forget the moment that we saw that.
Yeah, I know.
We got the video, where we rented the video, and we were watching it in my apartment. And when Ace said that, you and I just cracked up. That was a great moment.
Yeah, it was. Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's
hey,
it, man.
I think we're done. We're a minute, hour 15. I'll edit it down a little bit. But,
good, good.
Yeah, great stuff. Hey, this was fun. It's nice to be back in the saddle.
Yep.
Doing watching you. And all right. So this is Jeff Scott in St. John, New Brunswick.
And I'm Jeff Gray in Stewiacke, Nova Scotia.
Have a great evening, folks, and we'll see you again. Bye-bye.